After the scandals of the Nixon and Ford administrations, America wanted a different sort of leader. Against all odds, the American people found their answer in Jimmy Carter, the former governor of Georgia, to serve as president from 1977 through 1981. Carter was a Washington outsider and didn't have much experience in the realm of foreign policy. So before assuming office, Carter needed a crash course. Carter's advisors traveled to his home in Plains, Georgia in late 1976 to teach him about a few key themes. The Middle East was a priority. While previous administrations had succeeded in achieving certain agreements, opportunity existed for more. Arab countries had to be appeased, which Carter accomplished through favorable public statements and weapons sales. It was important to pressure Israel, beginning with a reexamination of U.S. military aid. It was crucial to embrace Egyptian President Anwar Sadat, who had turned away from the Soviet Union. And of course, emphasis was to be placed on Palestinian rights, which Carter pursued early on by making secret overtures to the PLO, a terrorist group. These ideas came primarily from Carter's national security advisor, Zbigniew Brzezinski. As a first step, Carter set out to reconvene the Geneva Conference. This was an effort to achieve a comprehensive settlement for the Arab-Israeli conflict. Carter needed to get all the parties to the negotiating table. Israel didn't like the Geneva formulation because it meant that they would be forced to negotiate with Syria, Jordan, Egypt, and the Palestinians, which was basically everybody else. Israel feared this formulation would impose dangerous outcomes, such as the creation of a Palestinian state and withdrawal from Jerusalem. Sadat objected because he wanted to limit Soviet involvement and he also didn't want to be on the same negotiating team as Syria. Egypt and Israel both wanted total freedom of decision-making with maximum flexibility. Sadat decided to take matters into his own hands, and in November of 1977, he made his historic trip to Jerusalem. Sadat's visit paved the way for direct contact between the Israelis and the Egyptians. For the very first time, the two countries started to engage in direct negotiations, first in Cairo and Jerusalem, and then at Leeds Castle in the UK. American mediators kept the negotiations going, however, progress stalled. The delegations couldn't come to an agreement on several crucial issues, such as the future of settlements, Israeli withdrawal from Sinai, a potential peace treaty, and Palestinian rights. Carter decided the only way to have success was to get the principal actors together in one place. He invited Egyptian President Anwar Sadat and Israeli Prime Minister Menachem Begin to join him for a trilateral conference at Camp David. The period from September 5th to September 17th, 1978, came to be known as the Camp David negotiations. The American and Egyptian positions were similar: full withdrawal from Sinai, a freeze on settlements, labeling Jerusalem as occupied territory, and a Palestinian state within 5 years. The Israeli delegation pushed back, and Begin, with the crucial assistance of his foreign minister Moshe Dayan, formulated terms that Israel would accept. After 13 grueling days, the three nations signed the Camp David Accords. The accords led to full Israeli withdrawal from the Sinai Peninsula, including settlements, and the signing of the Egypt-Israel Peace Treaty of 1979, which was the very first treaty between Israel and a formerly hostile Arab neighbor. Disagreements on Jerusalem and settlements in the West Bank continued to generate controversy between the U.S. and Israel for the remainder of the Carter administration. While the Egypt-Israel Peace Treaty has held for 40 years and set the precedent for the Israel-Jordan Peace Treaty of 1994, diplomatic agreements between Israel and her Arab neighbors in other areas, Jerusalem, Israeli settlements, and Palestinian rights, have continued to remain elusive.